Avast, cap'n, and walk the plank, you scurvy dog. Wait, we're British Navy. I mean, if you please, sir, kindly depart the boat at once. Cheerio. Farinaceous fruit, heated hedonism, and mutiny on the high seas. Let's learn the fun side story of Ned Young, the sleepiest man in history. Here at Fun Size History, we bring you short stories from the past for your busy day. Native to the South Pacific, there exists a fruit whose texture when cooked resembles freshly baked bread. In the mid-1700s, Captain James Cook, on a voyage of exploration, sampled this fruit and, being below average on creativity, named it breadfruit. The same captain was later killed in the Sandwich Islands, which we now know as Hawaii. Breadfruit sandwich. It's just poetic, right? Breadfruit was a cheap and high-energy food, and since the English were such stand-up guys, they were always looking for a cheap food for their slaves that wouldn't break the bank. England decided to send an expedition to the South Pacific to harvest several hundred breadfruit trees and later have them transplanted in the Caribbean, which was the home for most of the slaves. The ship's name? The Bounty. The Bounty reached the island of Tahiti in about 1788 and got straight to work digging up breadfruit trees. During their 5-month stay, the men were dazzled by the island, and primarily by its women. Tahitians wore very little clothes, and their society was way more liberated when it came to sex. Various romances and hookups took place, and in that short time period, the ship's doctor noted 18 cases of STDs. Now, I made a previous video of how these diseases originally got to Tahiti, which you can access by clicking below. Beyond the sex, the sailors started to integrate into Tahitian society. We know they even started peppering their English with Tahitian words, and some of them even elected to be tattooed in the traditional way on most of their body. All in all, they liked it there, and the prospect of being cooped up on a ship for another year with a bunch of dudes didn't sit right. A few days after leaving Tahiti, Captain Bligh of the Bounty woke up to some of his men, including Fletcher Christian, a friend of his, tying him up and dragging him up on deck. Bligh and a large amount of sailors loyal to him were packed into a tiny boat and set adrift. Unbelievably, Bligh survived, managing to navigate the boat 4,000 miles to Dutch Indonesia and only losing one man to an attack by a hostile islander. But that's a story for another day. Christian took command of the boat, and this is where we get to our boy, Ned Young. Ned had apparently slept through the entire mutiny. Man, those Navy hammocks must be comfy. They returned to Tahiti, and knowing full well they all would be hanged if the British Navy caught them, the mutineers started to plan to sail for a new home. While some of them had developed lasting bonds with their Tahitian wives, let's not kid ourselves that these sailors were hopeless romantics. They wanted more women before they sailed to a new home, so they devised a plan. During a party they threw on the boat, Christian cut the anchor cable, the boat drifted off, and they effectively kidnapped a large group of natives. Their first stop was a nearby island to drop off 6 women that were deemed too old. Not a fan of cougars, I guess. But several Polynesian men remained on board as well, so maybe they wanted a dude's night here or there. Now they went off in search of a new island. Christian learned of a small place named Pitcairn Island. They followed their map but found nothing where their island was supposed to be. But being quite determined to save their skins, they decided to keep searching along the recorded line of longitude. 200 miles later, they found it. Pitcairn had food, water, no place to land a large ship safely, and was mapped far from its actual location, aka the perfect hideout. While the small community originally set up shop and thrived, things quickly took a dark turn. The Polynesian men were treated as slaves, and the Polynesian women were sometimes shared between the Europeans and often lapsed into depression. Everything boiled to a head when one of the sailor's wives accidentally fell to her death off a cliff. The sailor demanded a replacement wife from the Polynesian men, one who was already being shared. This was the last straw, and the Polynesian men cooked up a scheme to kill all the Europeans in revenge. On a day now known as Massacre Day, the Polynesians began their killing spree. They attacked every European except Ned, who we know was protected by the women. Some later works of fiction imagine that he was actually sleeping during the killings and later hidden under a blanket. If so, this would make him the sleepiest man in history. Only 4 Europeans survived the attack, and the Tahitian women sided with them, killing all the Polynesian men in retribution. Things slowly calmed down until one sailor named McCoy managed to distill liquor from the roots of the tea plant. Now everything went to hell. McCoy drowned himself in a drunken stupor, and Matthew Quintal, another notorious drunk, started threatening to kill all the children on the island. Ned and the third sailor, John Adams, agreed he had to die, and they hacked Quintal to death with an axe. I guess Ned finally had some coffee that morning. A few years later, Ned died from asthma, leaving John Adams the sole Englishman to tell the whole story when a ship chanced upon Pitcairn decades later. But was Ned really that ridiculously sleepy? The story we get is all over the place. This is partly because John Adams told a different version of the story to every group of sailors that landed on Pitcairn. While he was old by then, it appears he was terrified of being tried and executed, and his story seems to spend extra time making him look like a good guy. We do get a slightly different version of events, less colored by fear, and maybe more accurate. Long after Pitcairn had been rediscovered and visited by many ships, an Australian reporter caught up with a woman who had been there for it all, but had left the island. This was Jenny, John Adams' former wife. Her account gives us some evidence that Ned wasn't quite as innocent as previously thought. You see, Ned kept a journal that wasn't quite exhaustive. It only starts after Massacre Day and records really trivial things like the crops they grew yearly, but omits big things like McCoy's suicide. Ned's journal is actually how we know that McCoy figured out how to make alcohol. But Jenny remembers that it was Ned who made it. Why would Ned lie? Well, alcohol had caused quite a bit of suffering on Pitcairn, but then maybe he would lie about other things. He was suspiciously the only one not to be attacked on Massacre Day. And there are some extra factors here. We learn that Ned was probably a mulatto, born of an Englishman and an African woman in the Caribbean. Being darker skinned than the English and seeing how the Polynesians had been treated, maybe he thought he was next. Or maybe it was something more simple. Ned's wife, Susan, had a child who she named Edward Quintal. Notice the different last name. Maybe Ned found out that his wife was cheating and decided to get rid of the other man. Whatever the truth is, and as often happens in history, we'll never really know. But that's the fun part, right? This story has captivated the imaginations of audiences since the Mutiny, with a multitude of books being written and movies being made. Fletcher Christian is always the swashbuckling protagonist and always played by the hunkiest dudes of the day. Errol Flynn, Clark Gable, Marlon Brando, and Mel Gibson. Need I say more? Yet while we uncovered evidence that there may have been a different mastermind at work, it seems that everyone still forgets about sleepy old Ned. That's all. Remember, history isn't just kings and dates. It's a story of you and me, just in different circumstances. One big soap opera, and we should learn it that way. Let me get you guys to like and subscribe, like and subscribe, like and subscribe. Check me out on Instagram, Reddit, and Patreon. Till next time.